Welcome to Politics Done Right on KPFT. I am your host, Egberto Williams. This is the progressive program that will take the mystery out of politics. This is the program that will encourage you to make sure government becomes we the people. Whether you are liberal, conservative, or otherwise, you get to air your point of view. Give me a call at 713-526-5738. That is 713-526-KPFT. Remember, you can also send me a tweet to EGBERTOWILLIES. That is at Egberto Williams. Let us engage. It is politics done right.
1, 2, 3, 4.
Well, folks, welcome to one more edition of Politics Done Right. I'm Egberto Willis, your host. Shannon.
Egberto.
How art thou doing?
I am doing very well. And I love the way you made that little Shakespearean.
You like that, eh?
How art thou?
In
a celebration of his 400th anniversary of his death this week.
You know, you would know that, but I don't know things like that. I am not one of those.
Well, it certainly sounded like you did.
That's what's important. You see what I'm saying? But you know, it's hot in here, folks.
It is.
The air conditioners are, what's wrong?
They're fixing them.
Okay, well, folks, you know what that means? You got to keep your community radio ventilated, right? My wife is in here with me. Right, Linda? We're supposed to keep it just right, right?
Right.
She didn't think the mic was going to pick her up. It said yes. But, folks, today we are going to have a great show. I have to say one thing before I start the show. However, I got an email that's going to be in the blog of the week. And you know, Shannon looks over all this stuff meticulously. And Shannon read the thing and she said, Egberto, guess what? You can't say that on air.
And just so you know, clarification purposes, it's not for censorship purposes. It is for FCC regulations.
Shannon censored Egberto. Remember that, folks. Shannon censored me.
Don't even get that one started.
Okay. Anyhow, folks, look, let me tell you if I can actually get to my sheet here. Many people believe that the Democratic primary is all but over, mathematically speaking. It is not yet over, folks. There are about 10 more states to go, and anything could happen, including the unforeseen. As such, no one should disengage. When it is all over, still no one should disengage. In fact, disengagement is directly responsible for the dysfunctional government and the continued growth of the American oligarchy, the American plutocracy. But before I get to the program, I want to remind all our listeners that KPFT is a bastion of intelligent voices and programs. As a political activist, my favorites are The Monitor with Mark Bebawi on Mondays at 7 p.m., Think Wing Radio with Mike Honig at 9 p.m. on Mondays, Partisan Gridlock, and I know you do that show, right, Shannon? Partisan Gridlock, what time is that show?
That is at 3 p.m. on Fridays.
3 p.m. Jeff Berg, great show. And of course, my good old friend, Jazz Latino Afro-Cuban Latin Jazz, as it is very best hosted by Juan Flores on Mondays at 10 p.m. And look, I forget to write it here all the time. Juan also does a program on Thursdays at noon on HD3. So don't forget, check it out, folks. Check out all our schedule at kpft.org, where you can find programming from music to politics to medicine to the eclectic. KPFT is listener-supported public community radio station. So please remember that if you like what you hear, visit kpft.org and ensure we remain a strong, viable community radio station that provides news, programming, and information not influenced by whom? The corporatocracy. Anyhow, folks, this is KPFT 90.1 FM, Houston, Texas. We want to hear your voice. We want to hear your thoughts. Let's talk. I will also be following our hashtag PoliticsDoneRight. So if you have something to say, do remember, just send us a tweet at PoliticsDoneRight, folks. Anyhow, let me tell you before we get into the blog of the week. It's about 900 words. It's a tad bit longer, but I want you to get the essence of what we're going to talk about. So guess what? Do you know what time it is?
It's time for the weekly blog post.
And let me just give you a little errata before I start. Remember, blog of the week this week, first time in Politics Done Right's history, was censored by Shannon McKerchie.
Really?
Anyhow, let's get busy. No, she's going to make sure that we stay on air. That's what she's going to do. Okay, folks, here we go. Many Bernie Sanders supporters were depressed after Hillary Clinton won 4 out of 5 primaries in the Northeast. They need not be. The political revolution has not materialized. It is what? It is materializing, folks. It isn't about a man. It is about a movement. Right, Shannon? It isn't about a man. What it is about?
That is so true. A movement.
It is a movement. Hillary Clinton has not won yet, but absent a complete meltdown on her party or on her part, self-inflicted or otherwise, she will be the Democratic nominee. Math is, guess what, folks? Absolute. Mathematics, absolute. Those who believe in real democracy, one person, one vote, should not try to impose a different will on the majority. That would be hypocritical. Hillary would have gotten more votes. Hillary would have gotten more delegates. The process must play on. Of course, the revolution must continue. It is clear that many believe that some who voted for Secretary Clinton were misled or misinformed. But guess what? Many Hillary Clinton supporters feel the same way about Bernie Sanders supporters as well. Our triggers differ. Some people believe that we need revolutionary change. Some people want incremental change. Some people believe we need revolutionary change, but they believe the only option is to settle for incrementalism. The latter two positions are likely to win in the Democratic Party this cycle. When the day is over, win or lose, both Bernie and Hillary will be fine. All must remember, the average supporter is just that, a supporter in a sea of supporters that ultimately means little to individual candidates. Let me back up from the thing. Let me tell you what I really want to say there. These candidates, they give big speeches and they come out and they talk to us, Bernie and Hillary as well. But ultimately, we are just the peons. Bernie's a nice guy. Hillary's a nice woman. But we are peons in the game. We have to demand what we want and don't expect them to give. Ultimately, that's what I mean. We should carry no personal baggage for either candidate. It is a job of those who believe that America needs a revolutionary change to convince those who think differently to reevaluate their positions. This has to be done by developing mutual respect between parties. Both parties must stop talking past each other. And when I'm talking about parties, I'm talking about factions within the Democratic Party specifically. I don't know if I've made that clear enough in the blog, but that's what I meant. This has to be done by developing mutual respect between both parties. Both parties must stop talking past each other and speak to each other. Last week, I posted a conversation I had on my radio show, on this show, with co-founder of Bernie or Bust. I know if you guys listened, you remember what he had to say. We had a positive dialogue on air. A Daily Coast reader, after I placed that snippet of the show on Daily Coast, and by the way, Daily Coast gets over 50 million hits or something like that a month. So, I mean, you expect to get this sort of stuff when you put it there. He sent me what has to be called a not very kind piece of mail. And this is one that Shannon edited. Here's a funny thing. He spelled my name with 2 G's. So that's the first word in his email was bad. E-G-G, egg, Berto. No, it's not the egg that you fry. Thank you very much. But anyway, this is what he says. Egg, Berto, and I start with the edit. Can I say, F off. That's how he starts his email to me. Then he says, I don't need any Bernie or Bust movement to have already decided that I cannot vote for Hillary Clinton under any circumstances. This lesser evil has to stop. Stop telling me that. When the majority of people in both parties are lazy numbskulls, not paying attention to the corruption of each party's establishment candidates, yep, HRC is as corrupt as they come, ignoring a historic opportunity to vote for an honest, consistent, principled, effective leader like Senator Sanders, and instead engaging in tepid personality politics, that I then have to choose between this exclamative candidate and the exclamative candidate that the party duopoly puts up in the general election. In other words, he doesn't want anybody to tell him to vote one of the duopoly's candidates. Okay? I don't think I lost too much of the meanings by missing those. Anyway, and he continues. The problem for Democrats is that too many overprivileged and ignorant people are willingly blind to HRC's many, and that he placed in there, negatives, and that on balance, she's already done more harm than good for most people. And most of the good deeds she takes credit for were no-brainers that any public official would have done. Money to rebuild New York after 9/11? Like there wouldn't have been money to rebuild Lower Manhattan if Hillary Clinton, Joan of Arc Clinton, hadn't been New York Senator at the time. Give me a break. The money would have been there for New York, even if you've been the senator. First woman as president? Yes, it's the right time, but it's the wrong woman being shoved down our throats. I, however, admonish him for the stance of his movement, which is dangerous for many poor and middle-class Americans. That's what I said in the thing, and he quoted me. And then this is how he referred to me. Admonish yourself, you egotistical, and Shannon told me not to use that word, who the, you know what, are you to presume to admonish anyone about how they want to vote? When will people get it through their heads that HRC doesn't give a turd about people, I don't think you could cross that one out, poor and middle class Americans, any more than any Republican candidates. Get your head out of your blank. She was there watching me. Okay. Now, my response, of course, you guys know from listening to Politics Done Right for a long time,
is diplomatic as always.
It's going to be diplomatic. So here's the response, okay? Sir, the tone of your email sent to me is probative. You do not convince those we need convincing by exhibiting the acrimony you show. If we want to change people, we have to do the hard job of earning people's respect and trust, even if you think they're dumb and you are a genius. Once that is done, they will be willing to listen. Yes, it is slow and tedious. The new indoctrination by the right started methodically with the Powell Manifesto. It was a job well done. We have a lot of work to do. I can take the verbal abuse that you just gave me. I've got a thick skin and I always keep my eye on the ball. Most cannot take it, however, and as such, your anger will accomplish nothing. If we are unable to convince people to vote for Bernie, not voting for Hillary in the general will feel good. But it is a fact that more people will get hurt by that move. Several of my colleagues here at KPFT disagree with that statement, but it's okay. That is what I believe. Others have the choice of believing otherwise, but we have to see the big picture. I am taking the time to respond to an otherwise uncivil email, urging you and those in your sphere not to just think through one level, but through the dominoes of outcomes. In my humble opinion, we need you engaged, not just during the election, but after, so that we prep and educate for the next. One cannot, and that's the end of the email I sent him. We're back to the blog proper. One cannot have a political revolution with a lesser amount of followers. It was disconcerting watching political pundits make fun of the political revolution. They do not see the big picture, but many building the political revolution do not either. Things that are rigid break explosively. That is one of the first things we learned in the engineering classes. Large gradients create massive problems. Any engineers call in and tell me what you think. Anyhow, it is not enough to be right. It is not enough to have most or even all the answers. A movement requires work. It requires the ability to take a hit, regenerate, and continue. This is the time to coalesce the revolution movement that will be necessary to fight the continued strengthening of the plutocracy. And that's the end of the blog of the week. Folks, all lines are open. 713-526-5738. Again, that number is 713-526-5738. I want to hear from you guys because you know I can go talking on forever. But I'd rather talk to you. Again, the number is 713-526-5738. Shannon, this is the first time I think on this show that I've finished the blog of the week and there's not one call on.
The first time in my memory, that's
yes,
for sure.
First time ever. You know what that means?
What does that mean?
We got to engage and start talking because they're saying, okay, we want to hear a little bit more. What do you think about the election? What happened?
Well, I think, you know, whenever I got the report on my phone that, the, you know, it's about, she has 90%, Hillary has 90% of all
the delegates
at this part, you know, I don't disagree with her, mm-hmm. you know. I believe Bernie brought up this movement in, because he's saying what needs to be said, that we do not need our candidates bought and sold. We
right.
need to make sure that they have our values at heart. And that's an important issue that I hope will persevere.
Yeah, I think it will. You see, we started talking and what happens? The phones start ringing. Anyhow, folks, she's coming to you right now. Shannon is actually right. Let me tell you something about movements. I want to talk mostly to the younger folks. A lot of folks out there are depressed. I spoke to quite a few of them on Facebook yesterday. They're depressed that the candidate they place so much hope in is likely not going to become the candidate, and they're thinking about sitting out the election or just doing something other than what folks want them to do. I hope you listen to the show, and I hope we get into some reasons to convince folks to do what's right, not only for feeling good for a few minutes, but what's right going forward. Before I go to line number one, let me remind you folks, the telephone number is 713-526-5738. Again, that number is 713-526-5738. Please don't wait till the end of the show where we then have to try to pass everybody quickly. Okay, numero uno, who are we with?
Amanda.
Amanda, talk to me, Amanda. How are you doing?
I'm good. How are you doing?
Talk to me. Great, great, great.
Good. Well, I kind of caught the end of the blog session, but I was curious if you could talk a little bit about taking the revolution local, because we hear a lot about national politics every 4 years, but there doesn't seem to be any engagement at the local, county, city, school district, all of those levels. I think voter turnout's
Amanda,
5%.
Amanda, let me tell you, you are genius. You are genius. Let me tell you why. All politics is local. It is true that a lot of bloggers, including myself, have a tendency to concentrate mostly on the national election. And that is, for now you can understand it, right? Because right now it's national, it's Bernie Sanders. And we really have, we've seen with Bernie Sanders and with Hillary Clinton, but mostly with Bernie Sanders, a real movement that we hadn't seen sort of developing. In other words, yes, Obama had a movement in 2008, but I call Obama's movement a bit more on the lighter side. We finally started to look in this current movement. I don't want to use the word socialist because the words are going to be misinterpreted, but we really started looking at really providing public services and demands by the average person, which is something President Obama, because of who he was, would have never touched. Now, going back to your specific question as far as doing things locally, you're absolutely right. And what I tell people all the time is, how do we do it? How do we actually start to establish a local movement? The way we do that, I think, is we start trying, we build a lot of little groups. And I've actually started seeing it develop. And I'm a member of several, what do you call that? Not LinkedIn. What's that other thing where you
put
meetups. We've started having a whole lot of different meetups right now with people on different different issues. It just hasn't gotten the size that it needs to be yet. But the mere fact that you brought that up means that you should be one of the persons involved in starting one of this and using shows like ours. Because remember, what are we? We are community radio here. You called in and you said, what are we going to do on a local level? My question to you wouldn't be, well, I know what we need to, or isn't going to be to tell you, I know what we need to do on the local level. My question to you is, what do you think we need to do on the local level that we're not doing right now? You tell me, that you have the floor, the audience listens, we start with a meetup. We start with some way to get started on the particular issue you want to work on. Whether you have it now or not, platform is yours.
Yeah, well, I think that, you know, if Bernie Sanders can draw however many 3 million people and activate people who weren't activated before, we need to get those lists, have him share those lists, and really start mobilizing in between those cycles, you know, as much as we can. Without just saying go vote, but give them options that they're motivated to get out for.
I agree with you wholeheartedly. There are new forms online. I think change.org has one, has a platform that allows you to create sort of petition-like things that you can use to drive traffic, let's say, to your website on an issue that you want, and you can expand from that. Those are some things that I think we can do. Also, we can actually use the Facebook and the Meetup type platforms to do things like that. There are people doing it right now. None of this gets a whole lot of coverage right now because ABC, CBS, NBC, and these stations aren't going to cover it. But let's give a for instance. Let's, for instance, that you wake up tomorrow and you think of a project that you want to do, and you get a meetup and you get to activate 10 people. And then you call into a show like Minds or Mike's or some other one of these shows and say, hey, we are going to be doing XYZ. Suddenly, you have an on-air presence that you can give more visibility to your group. We are a community station. That is what we're for, the things that those other guys aren't going to do.
And possibly if we could get Bernie as, you know, I know we don't want to hear this or talk about it, but if he weren't to get the nomination, but to use his platform to really send that message of,
right,
you know, do the right thing, avoid catastrophe, and then go back to where you live in your neighborhood and go work there too.
I agree with you wholeheartedly, ma'am. I agree with you wholeheartedly. So again, remember, you're a part of it as well. Anytime, you do something, you give us a call if you want something out there of the community service that we're doing, and we'll move on in that. Anything else you want to say before we go to the next caller, ma'am?
No, just thank you for getting the word out and doing what you do.
Thank you very much. You have a great day, Amanda.
Thank you.
Excellent. Let's go to line two with Don. Folks, we still have open line 713-526-5738. Again, that number is 713-526-5738. Open lines. Don, how are you doing?
I'm doing pretty good.
Talk to me, my friend.
Yeah, I was just part of it where the deflation of those who wanted Bernie to win.
Yes.
And it became... A lot of people, I listened last week when it was the talk of the Bernie or bust.
Yes, sir.
And it feels like a thing of when the New York primaries happened and the last primaries that just happened, it felt like the establishment won.
Right.
because the establishment, before anybody ever placed a vote, already wanted Hillary Clinton.
Right.
And one of those disservices to, I think, America as a whole is whenever certain stations will have people talk, they won't say that they're super delegates that are for Hillary Clinton. They'll just say, oh, yeah, well, this is what I believe. There's no way Bernie can win. But those people are all super delegates for Hillary Clinton that are pushing for Hillary to win, and they treat Bernie as a joke.
Mm-hmm. Let me tell you, first of all, I want to answer that. Yes, and I think I mentioned that in the blog as well. Bernie is treated as a joke by many. He will continue to be treated as a joke by many in the establishment. And the reason why is if you try to it goes with any person, group, or whatever that is marginalized. The best way to move attention away from them is the attempt to marginalize them. How do you marginalize somebody? By making them seem not important, by making them seem not serious. One of the things I try to do is I try to prop up everybody. In other words, we need to make sure that nobody is insignificant. And when it comes to Bernie proper, we, the other folk, because the reason I'm talking about propping up everybody, right, is Bernie can only get the insignificant vibe or treatment if his people feel insignificant and they don't react to that feeling of insignificance. However, if you get the lower folks on Bernie's side or on whomever side that you're supporting, I had another blog piece I call Know Your Worth, that you as a Bernie supporter is no less valuable than a Hillary supporter, than a Trump supporter, than a Cruz supporter. Once you get to that level, that is when people start treating you quite a bit better. In fact, Bernie's treatment got a whole lot better when that occurred, when he started winning, when people started to show up. Now, that said, I think it is important for folks to realize that you don't beat Goliath the very first time around, the second time around. I don't know who would expect the establishment to just sit down and say, we'll accept this guy that wasn't really, technically speaking, a Democrat till a long time to come and run our party. That is how a lot of these people think. That is how a lot of these people believe. He's not even, yes, he votes with the party, but remember, he's not. Look at all the things he's said about the party before. So, yeah. I mean, so they don't consider him a part of the party, and they would do whatever it takes to attempt to make him not be the leader of the party. But my contention is this, right? First of all, personally, I don't even believe in parties, right? We have parties. That's what we have right now. So that's what we have right now. But what I try to tell folks, or what I'm telling people right now, is Bernie, I think, created a movement that was an extension of the masses that that President Obama got together and kind of forgot after he got into office. And a lot of these guys got reactivated. And the worst thing that we could have happen right now is for that reactivation to go away. So I am saying to the people who are deflated right now, I think they should pick up their arms and say, you know, Bernie is just that, Bernie a man, and that what we really have to work on is work on building, keeping this movement up. Because whoever becomes president, and I'll be frank with you guys, and I'll come to the next caller in a little bit, but whoever becomes president, I'm not sure that that Trump won't be our next president. I know people think it's impossible, but I actually think Trump stands a very good chance of becoming the president of the United States. Okay.
That is terrifying.
It is terrifying, but it's true. I tell you something. I watch the way Trump has been campaigning. And I can tell you, I can see the psychology behind Trump winning. And just look at the psychology inside a KPFT. I am looking at one that tentatively would actually give somebody like a Trump a hearing. Not because he's enamored with Trump, but because of all the reasons I am saying Trump could actually win. And I'm going to give Jacob a quick time. You got 30 seconds to say what you got to say, because I don't like you anymore.
No, like, I don't even think I could say it in 30 seconds, but I'll try. No, I mean, simply the consideration isn't even necessarily about... it's mainly about, for a lot of us who are independently minded, but might actually place him on the board... It would probably be just to flip the table on this whole system. My I told you before, Eric. Right. My ideal scenario would be a competitive four person race in the general. That would completely change.
And that I think I would agree with you. But Jacob, I got to leave you because our lines are full to the top. Do me a favor. Let me tell you, Don. You have anything quickly to say before I jump to the other caller?
Oh yeah, I was just going to talk about exactly what you just said about the. Treating Bernie like a joke. They also treated Trump as a joke.
Yes.
But the problem was that Trump got ratings.
Thank
as
you.
A joke.
Exactly.
And Bernie is not a quote-unquote sexy candidate,
right,
as Trump is as a ratings monster.
Absolutely.
And also, going towards Hillary Clinton, whenever Hillary was asked about if she would try to get the Bernie supporters, she just laughed it off and said she's already winning. Why does she need to go after those supporters? That shows that we have to hold her feet to the fire.
Right.
Way more than what we're doing now.
Right. What I tell, I don't know that recently she hadn't said it that way, but that's she has been more compromising. But let me just say this, Don, and that is, whoever is president, this movement doesn't depend on it being a Democrat, a Republican, or whatever. If this movement is successful, whoever is president will do what the movement says to do, because it would have been just that, a movement. And that's what I try to tell people more often than not. The reason, though, we are concerned about parties is the Supreme Court right now. But we can go into that another time. My lines are full down, so I need to move on. But look, thank you for calling. Keep listening and keep calling. Okay, my friend?
All right, thanks, man.
Take care now. Let's go to line three. I think line three is Rick. Come on in, Rick. How you
doing? And after him, we break.
Hola, mi compañero zapatista. How are you?
¿Cómo estás, mi amigo? Háblame.
Oh, well, I want to encourage the people not to give up on Bernie.
Okay.
I'm one of those baby boomers, Latino baby boomers, mm-hmm. that is following Bernie. And I know that the majority are millennials and such. And I know they realize that they're doing this because they know their future is bleak.
Right.
But I want to encourage them, because the message is out there already, okay? With guys like Bernie and with ladies like Elizabeth Warren,
mm-hmm.
the message is getting out there and is beginning to hurt.
Right.
Okay? It's like a little zancudo, a little mosquito just bugging them there, okay?
Está bien, hermano.
And I'm telling you, that bug is getting bigger and bigger, okay?
Well,
it's
look.
It's now a wasp, and the wasp hurts, okay?
Yes.
And it's gotten to the point now where, you know, the media wants, they try to minimize both of them.
Right.
And then when you get to the point where one of the Koch brothers says, I might even go for Hillary.
Yes.
You know, to lessen.
Imagine
to
that.
Lessen the Bernie Sanders, okay?
Right.
And I'm telling you right now, Bernie has got a plan. He's going to stick it out to the end. He's going to take it to the convention. He's going to bring it up.
Right, but
the opportunity is that because a lot of these primaries that he's lost have been closed primaries.
Right.
But he wins the open primaries.
Right.
But when he can get the independents to vote for him, you know, he's gonna scare people.
But Rick, let me just tell you what I want the people who are Bernie supporters to keep in mind, okay? The mm-hmm. likelihood of him becoming the candidate is slim. Now, that said, I want them to do, the followers, not to go home and cry, but to continue a movement and continue to realize their power. That's what I'm saying. What I don't want to do is, I don't want to give anybody listening to this show false hope that somehow there's a 60% chance that this guy can win. It's not so. So what I'm saying is, the probability is against him, but if he doesn't make it, folks mm-hmm. need to keep the movement going. I got to go to a station break. Rick, look, thank you very much. Tenga buen día. ¿Está bien?
Igualmente.
Ciao, mano. All right. All yours.
Why, thank you, Egberto. Okay, let's take a brief look at weather around town. It is currently 86 degrees in partly cloudy skies. About 40% chance of thunderstorms tonight and a low of 73 degrees. Tomorrow, expect partly cloudy skies in the morning that will give way to cloudy and windy conditions in the afternoon. And a 20% chance of rain and a high of 86 degrees. Let's take a brief look at our roadways. There is a clearing crew on the West Sam Houston Tollway southbound after Bel Air Boulevard that are cleaning up an incident on the center lane to left shoulder there. That's backing up traffic to Briar Forest. And there's an accident on the West Park Tollway inbound that's blocking the exit ramp to the Southwest Freeway. And on the South Loop eastbound at Broad Street, there's a multiple vehicle accident involving five vehicles affecting the center lane to right shoulder, backing up traffic to Scott. That's a look at your Houston area weather and traffic. I'm Shannon McCurchy, and you are listening to Politics Done Right, right here on KPFT Houston 90.1 with Egberto Willis.
Muchísimas gracias, mujer. Let's go to line number one with, I think that is Gary. Come on in, Gary.
Dios, ¿cómo está usted?
Estoy muy bien, Gary. Talk to me.
Bueno, I have two questions, and I'll hang up and listen.
Yes, sir.
Number one, what do you think the possibility is that Hillary will choose as her running mate Bernie Sanders?
Mm-hmm.
And number two, if Trump wins, wouldn't that be better than Ayatollah Cruz?
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you very much for that one, Gary. Okay, here's my response. I think the possibility of Bernie being Hillary's running mate is zero to none. Okay? I don't think once it is over, Bernie is likely to never make an appearance around Hillary Clinton again, in my opinion. I think that's how much she really does not like Bernie. That's my gut feeling. I could be completely wrong, but that's what I think. As far as, let's say, Donald Trump over Dr. Cruz, better known today as Lucifer by Boehner, you know, I have a lot of friends who tell me they would much prefer a Trump over Cruz because they are fearful of Mr. Cruz. You know, the truth of the matter is, the only thing that I would love for Cruz to get the nomination for is to see all the court battles about him. You know, I am not a birther or anything like that, but I mean, there are a lot of Republican birthers who don't like Cruz, and it will be kind of interesting to see how they come out on that particular issue. So for me, it would simply be a fun thing. Now, look, here's the real deal. I don't think any of those guys have a chance of winning. I don't think Cruz has a chance or Kasich has a chance of winning the Republican nomination. I think it's going to be Trump. And I don't only think it's going to be Trump. I think it's going to be Trump past the 1237 delegates that he needs. A lot of people think I'm crazy for saying that, but I think he's going to get it. I think everybody's starting to coalesce around Donald Trump, and they're trying to make him look like he knows what he's saying. Of course, we know better. So anyhow, let's go to line number four. Line number four is Herman. Come on in.
Hello.
How you doing, my friend?
I'm doing pretty good. I just wanted to say that, you know, you hit it right on the spot. Education is the key to everything.
Yes, sir.
A lot of people right now, when they didn't vote for Bernie at the beginning because they weren't informed about Bernie. So now they're wringing their hands like, why didn't we vote for this guy?
Right.
And then same thing goes with the Republicans. A lot of the Republicans weren't informed about Trump, and so they voted for Trump. And then now that things they're saying, why are we voting for this guy?
Well,
so education it goes both ways. You got to learn what you have on the table, so you can you know, get rid of the bad seeds and the good seeds. You know,
Herman, you're actually so right. You know, I mean, apathy has apathy is a double-edged sword, right? In this case, apathy is going to give us probably two people that really, you know, the truth of the matter is, I'm going to tell folks a dirty little secret. Trump is really a liberal. And it's going to be interesting to see what if he becomes president, what he actually does. Because while everybody feared that this guy is some new conservative hero, he is not. So we'll see what happens. And by the way, because he's not a real conservative, because he's really a liberal, and because many liberal Republicans know that, that is why I am fearful of Trump. Because Trump will not only get the conservative votes, because who are they going to vote for otherwise? But he's going to get a lot of crossover votes from people who simply, I mean, look, I could make the commercials for Trump right now. I mean, I have written enough blogs about Hillary and banking, Hillary and all these other issues. And let me just tell folks straight up, I know who I'm likely voting for. Okay, I'm not going to say because I'm on air, but you guys can infer. But the reality is, I can see the other side making quite a few claims that will stick with a whole lot of people, Herman.
Well, and then on the education part, we need to educate these young people so that they can be encouraged to run. That's the other issue, is that a lot of times, doesn't matter what party it is, we're not encouraging people to learn how to run. And
absolutely.
There was a call. That's why we have a failure of the candidates, because
and of our politics.
We don't have people to run.
Yeah, let me tell you something, Herman, because you're saying something that another caller came in and said, because all the times on my show I'd say, remember, go out there and vote. You must vote. And then a caller came in and called in and said, yes, Egberto, you must tell folks you must vote, but you almost tell them to run. To run. Right. To run. So look, Herman, my phones are all booked, so I need to let you go on this one and go to the next call. Okay, my friend?
You got it.
Have a good one, my brother. Let's go to line number five. William, come on in, William. How are you doing?
Hi, Berto.
Talk to me.
Hey, I got a short clip, and then I want to talk about what I really want to talk about.
Okay, let me hear the short one real quick.
Well, you know, Scalia, Mark Twain had a nice quote.
Okay.
It was, although I didn't attend the funeral, I sent a brief note, I approved.
Okay, what you really calling me for now, my friend?
Okay, I want to go back to Afghanistan and 60 Minutes when the Taliban took over the whole, all of Afghanistan before the Balkan incident, right?
Yes, yes.
And you know how they romanticized it, right?
Yes.
Okay, so now 2 weeks later, the antiquities get blown up. Now, do you think those antiquities might have been blown up by the same people that blew up the World Trade Center?
The truth of the matter is, I don't know.
Well, I mean, check this out. See, when they had that episode, they talked about how the Taliban had completely eliminated all the opium trade.
Okay.
Now, I'm from Detroit.
Okay.
And I knew that that put a big bell on my head. I said, well, heads are going to roll from here.
Okay.
Because they cut off the heroin trade, right?
Yes, William. Look,
and the Balkans was the pipeline.
William, I love what you're saying. I love your narrative. But
okay,
why are you...
Two.
Yes, yes,
please.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
I heard President Obama get interviewed like a week and a half ago about that 28-page report about 9/11.
Yes.
That the senator said that he believes that the people that they're saying pull that off could have never pulled it off. And then the interviewer that was interviewing Obama asked him if he's read the 28-page report. You know what Obama said?
He probably said no.
He said, I don't think I read the whole thing.
Right, right.
But, I mean,
William, I got to let you... William.
These people, feet should be held to the fire.
William, you're right. I got to let you go, William, but you got your point across, my friend, okay?
All right, later.
You take care, buddy. All right, let's go to line number 6 for Gary. Come on in, Gary.
Hey, good afternoon.
How you doing, sir?
Doing all right. How are you?
All right. Talk
excellent,
to me.
Excellent. Enjoying the show.
Thank you, sir.
I was just calling in to remind people a lesson I've learned in my life that not doing something actually means that you're doing something.
Thank you.
That is, if you decide you're not going to vote for, say, Hillary because, oh, I don't like her, in effect, you're voting for the other person or whoever it is.
You know, that is very important for people to know. But, I mean, some people, let me just say, from some good people that I know, they are not doing that and they really don't care. But what I tell those good people, those good friends of mine, uh-huh, is that while they can live comfortably under either administration or under no matter what occurs, maybe with just a little less comfort,
mm-hmm,
I don't only think of myself. I don't only think of the folks around me who will be just fine. But you have to think about those who would really be hurt.
Really, consequences, yeah.
And what I think you are pointing out when you say that is that there are so many people who have a lack of empathy. Not that they're bad folk, but they just have a lack of empathy. They are unable to put themselves or see themselves through the eyes of others. And if we can get folks to stop being that way, and I think we can. The problem is that, you know, again, as Herman just talked about, mm-hmm, we have a whole lot of educating to do, and you're one of the people educating, because your statement alone just went to several thousand people here in the Houston area, and you just educated a few.
The lesson I learned. And the other quick thing I was going to say is the movement isn't really going to go away. I think there are lots of grassroots things that are happening, and for example, one that caught my eye is called brandnewcongress.org, which
right,
is a group of people trying to replace the elect an accountable Congress to
right,
get Bernie's program going and replace the Congress basically all at once.
Absolutely.
Already on board.
Well, you know, I'm glad that you mentioned that, because earlier another caller, I think her name was Amanda, who called in and said the same thing. She said that we needed to start working, yes, have the movement going, but also working locally,
sure,
in what we're doing. And from what you're saying there, that is what you're talking about. So look, yeah, you're absolutely right, sir.
Act local, think global.
Absolutely. You're right, sir. Thank you very
much.
So much. Keep on moving up, and you have a great day. Okay,
you,
my friend?
You too. Bye-bye.
Take care now. Okay, let's go to line number 2. I think that is Bruce. Come on in, Bruce.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Enjoy your program. You're a very wise man. You, we can assume now Trump and Hillary are going to be the candidates.
That's a good possibility.
It's safe to say.
Yes.
And like I say, don't get your hopes up. I've called before. If you're a Hillary supporter in Texas, it's not going to happen in Texas.
Right.
And so... Sorry, but there's other reasons. back to what you said, not to get negative on Hillary, back to what you said, that Trump candidacy, presidency, may not be all that bad.
Okay.
I mean, we may have to start wrapping our head around him being president.
Let me tell you something.
I'm a union member, and I'm a supporter of KPFT, so don't think that's what I'm not. I'm on that.
Look, wait. Let me tell you, first of all, Bruce, what you know when you call into my show, you can have any point of view. It doesn't matter to me. You know, but the reason I laughed is that I think you're right. For all the people that are salivating for a Hillary Trump meeting, because Hillary is going to clean Trump's clock, I think they're out for a rude awakening. First of all, they don't.
With Bernie almost out of the picture, the Republicans still fighting. Hillary's going to have to, Ben, the eyes are going to be on her, and part of what I don't want to get too deep into it, but I'm going to go back in my history. First, I'm going to start looking at her record as Secretary of State, the Arab Spring. America has a heavy hand of destroying Gaddafi.
I'm interrupting you for one reason, Bruce, and it's because I don't want to get into the Gaddafi, the emails, all that good stuff with Hillary.
I wasn't getting into the emails, just in general, the hawkishness.
Right.
The hawkish record. I wasn't getting into the emails.
Right.
I'm going deeper than that.
Okay.
Not the Benghazi, no, sir.
Mm-hmm.
A little deeper than that. And okay. Back to Clinton with Bosnia, installing NATO when the Soviet bloc fell.
Right.
NATO, there's a record there that now with Bernie out of the picture, there may be more focus on her. It may have been better off for her to have a longer contest with Bernie. And now if she's the presumptive nominee, there's going to be more focus on her. And I don't...
Right.
I'm sorry, I don't...
Well, you know, let me give you a quick little narrative here, Bruce, and it goes as follows, right? What we're going to find is that as far as it comes to Hillary versus Trump, that Trump is going to create a new narrative. I am a self-made man. Nobody can tell me what to do. I don't take money from anybody. And the electorate right now is in one of those moods.
That will sell.
That's my point. That is my point. I mean, it's not going to sell to everybody. It's not going to sell to the diehard Hillary supporters. But I know enough, I know enough supporters of everybody else that talks to them. You know, they will actually fall for that message. I am a self-made person, and I'm not taking any money from anybody. Of course, he will be taking money from other folks later on. But the narrative is going to be there.
And on the Trump side, the people that tell me they're Trump supporters, I almost feel sorry for them because they buy that.
Right. So, I mean, the thing about it is this. Bottom line is this, and then I got to go to the next caller, Bruce. Bottom line is this. I think you're absolutely right. We could have a President Trump. Now, a lot of people heads are exploding as they hear me say that. But I'm telling folks, look, I can name a whole lot of presidents that nobody thought could possibly be president.
Yes, I'll get off the line. I survived Johnson. I survived Nixon. I survived Gerald Ford.
All right, my friend.
We're going to be okay.
You take care, my friend. Thank you for calling. Keep calling. Keep listening.
Thank
okay,
you
my friend.
Work.
You take care, buddy. Okay, let's go to line number one. James, come on in.
Thank you, Egberto, for taking my call.
How you doing, sir?
Okay, I'm on a question and a comment first.
Yes, sir.
I want to say, why you can't get people to understand that even if Trump become president, why are they clamoring for a billionaire, and why are they putting their trust in a man who's a billionaire to do things in their best interest when this game politics got him what he has?
Yeah.
And if you have, you are surrounded by millionaire, billionaire friends, and an issue come up, a policy come up in the government, Who do you think he's going to consider first?
Of
the
course.
Money or the people?
You know something? Look, your comment is a very smart comment. Here's an important thing. Why do people sit down and believe that some billionaire really cares about them? Sir, you're absolutely right. Here's a problem, though. Again, I always jump back to a blog. I always try to put this blog out that says, we don't understand our own worth. Yeah. We Americans have a self-esteem problem. We look at somebody who trades stocks, who takes a piece of paper and says, this is worth more than that. This piece of paper is worth more than that. We don't mind those people getting billions. But a mother who goes to McDonald's every day and goes to work and try to take care of her kids and ask for a little assistance from society, we consider her a beggar. We consider her less than. And she thinks she is less than. But she is doing more work than the guy who is shuffling those papers. It's a self-worth issue. When Americans start to realize that they are all equally valuable, I'm talking about as human beings. When Americans start to not only hear that or say that, everybody says, oh, I'm good. But when they start really believing that they are really worthy, then they'll look at guys like Trump or Hillary or the moneyed people and realize that they bleed red, they hurt just as much, and all these things are true. So you're correct, James.
Another thing, if they think that you think this movement that Barney has started is going to last, let me see what happens went to the movement when they dropped the gas down to, let's say, $1. All of a sudden, everybody feeling good over a little $1, little
right.
2 cents. And then, you know, everybody's comfortable. As long as we have choices in America to be comfortable or sacrifice a little bit, Americans going to choose comfort.
Let me tell you something, man. You're such a smart man. There's a friend of mine. She did a video called Bread and Circus. And what it talks about is how a plutocracy keeps power. The way a plutocracy keeps power is it gives people enough bread, enough food,
yes,
to keep them satisfied, and it gives them a whole lot of entertainment. That's where the circus comes in. In today's world, we have all these reality TV series. We have all the great movies out there. So we keep people entertained. We can have performers come out with junk that gets a whole lot of play on major TV stations. They're entertained, and we give them cheap food. Americans have the cheapest food around the world.
Ed Bailey, you have a lot of education to do,
right,
and I'm going to be listening. And my question is, if you think, let's say Donald Trump, Bernie Sanders get the nomination, who do you think will win out of Trump and Bernie Sanders?
Bernie Sanders. And I tell you why. Because for once, Americans are going to feel that somebody is running like them and actually got there like them. In other words, until he is able to cross cross over that line, if he was able to cross over that line, I'm pretty darn sure he would beat he would beat a Trump.
And I beg to differ, because unless he's able to get into that white, unless he's able to change
worthiness,
Supreme Court
right
decision about money and politics, if he don't fix that system where he sits, that
I'm
right
gonna,
now
I would have been
Senate,
yeah
then,
James.
Then, the money that Trump has is going to defeat him.
Hey, James, I'm running out low on time, but I want to say one quick thing to you about that. I would have answered that question exactly the same way as you did about 3 weeks ago, or more than about 3 months ago. But what we started to realize in this particular election, that money has a whole lot less power in the political system than it did before. It's almost like the virus is no longer working. But I got to let you go, James.
Tell the media that. Okay.
Thank you, my brother. You have a good one. Okay, let's go to line number three. Line number three. Let's go to Chris. Come on in, Chris. You have about a minute. Chris, okay, Chris isn't on, so let's go to line number two. Come on in, John.
Good afternoon, Egberto.
Hey, John, how you doing, my friend?
Good, good. I know you're getting back into this Trump can win mode, and yeah, anything
yes,
is possible.
Yes, I am.
I would put it at less than 10%, though. Right now, if you look at matchups based on polling, the numbers would be Hillary Clinton 375 electoral votes, Donald Trump 138.
Right.
No, 163 rather. I'm sorry. Mm-hmm. So I mean, she has leads right now in Arizona, Georgia, Missouri, and Utah. These are states that Obama
right.
didn't win. So that's why this is such a mismatch. And, all you have to do is look at his numbers, 70% disapproval rating among women. Mm-hmm. He can't overcome that.
Let me tell you one thing. Let me just break you in for one quick second here. All of those numbers are true, right? You know what? Look at the exit polls from Pennsylvania. And you know what Pennsylvania showed you? He won women. He won just about every demographic in Pennsylvania. Even from
yeah,
people...
Yeah, among Republicans.
Yes.
Among Republicans.
Yes, yes.
I mean, he's losing in head-to-head. Like I said, there's not one state that he's ahead that Obama won that he's winning in.
Right.
Not one.
I hope you're right. I hope you're right.
Well,
I really do.
I mean... As far as Texas, there was one poll in November. Hillary Clinton was only down 2 points. There was mm-hmm. a poll in Mississippi in late March. Hillary Clinton was only down 3 points. These are states that Obama lost by double digits. And then Trump is not a serious general election candidate, and I don't think he's going to spend much money either, because he's not going to have the Republican base. They're going to be running away from him. They want to keep the House and the Senate. This lead is going to get bigger.
Let me tell you,
and they're going to run
John,
away from him.
John, I hope you're right. By the way, I see all the polls that you're talking about, right? But I'm not looking at for now. I wasn't
two
looking
minutes.
At, yeah, I'm not looking at the polls specific to that we have right now for one specific reason, and that is. I've seen it, in my opinion, that is. And again, this is just an opinion. You could be right. And in fact, we would all prefer you to be right. And, right now the stats are on your side. My thing is that I know that stats change, as a general election come along. And my fear is that people just think and take it for granted that, we don't really have to worry because it's going to be a walkthrough. I honestly don't believe that. But again, that is just my belief. That is just my belief,
right.
And I could be wrong.
Let me say that Kasich actually had a 100 delegate lead over Clinton. He was at 309.
Right. Yeah, I saw
that.
So,
I mean, so it's not the Republican orthodoxy that has been rejected. It's Trump and
right.
Cruz specifically, because they are extremists, even within the Republican Party, which is
right.
an extreme party.
Well, brother, I really hope you are right, John. But, John, we are at the close of the show. This is the first time you've been the last caller on the show. Normally, you're the first caller on the show. What
yeah,
happened?
Had a late lunch. But it's a good show. Definitely a good show and a good blog. I always enjoy it.
Thank you very much, John. You have a wonderful day, okay, my friend?
All right. Thank
Great.
You.
Well, folks, we are at the end of Politics. One more edition of Politics Done Right. I really appreciate the hour that you gave me. You have a wonderful day. Again, this is Politics Done Right, Egberto Willis, and I am out.
Thank you very much for listening to Politics Done Right. I am your host, Egberto Willis. You can personally reach me by sending an email to egberto@politicsdoneright.com. Remember, Egberto is spelled EGBERTO. Change starts with you. 90.1 KPFT gives you information not tainted by corporate interest. Please visit kpft.org and contribute. Let's ensure continued access to real information and news remain available to all. Again, thank you very much for listening to Politics Done Right.